welcome to Punjab Lalit Kala Akademi. It's a very prestigious moment for us because we, after the formation of the Punjab Arts Council and the Punjab Lalit Kala Akademi a few months back, this is our first program which we are beginning with none other than Sudarshan Shetty on the birthday of one of the most iconic artists of Punjabi origin. We wish that whoever we have lost to other cities, other nations from Punjab, that in future we are able to retain them back in Chandigarh. That is our effort. That's why people like Sudarshan Shetty are being invited, so that artists from this region, especially Punjab, get information from.
Subversive, edgy, unsettling, enigmatic. Sudarshan Shetty is comfortable with all these appellations. Perhaps he even enjoys them. For he is no ordinary artist making pleasing images. He is the maverick who eschews established symbolism and narrative, who juxtaposes incongruous mechanically moving objects to generate multitudinous meanings, who favors subversion, and who encompasses painting, poetry, music, philosophy, drama, cinema, sculpture, mixed media, and much more in his multi-layered artworks. Mangalore-born Shetty's early interest in painting brought him to the JJ School of Art, Mumbai, and then to the Kanoria Center for Art, Ahmedabad. But it was in sculpture and installation that he found his true rhythm. Venturing into explorations of the creative possibilities of molding objects and experimenting with new mediums, he created artworks that were an intriguing combination of the representational and the abstract. In 1995, his solo exhibition, Paper Moon, set him on path-breaking conceptualizations that have since attracted worldwide attention. Shetty believes that it's important to challenge modes of viewership. So he entices and often unsettles the viewer with quirky combinations, such as empty dinner jackets dipping in and out of vessels, scissors lined up in bathtubs, dinosaur skeletons on rocking horses or on cars, delicate wine glasses crushed to smithereens by heavy hammers, all to draw out the unspoken or the socially understated. Through the new dialogue that emerges from the startled and wondering engagement with his often whimsical installations, Shetty comments upon contemporary urban life, simultaneously undercutting its homogenizing effects. So, for example, Mumbai's Bandra Kurla complex sports the city's well-known double-decker bus taking on giant, shimmering steel wings, with a plaque stating, "Sometimes when we travel, we forget who we are." The undercurrent of philosophical musings in Shetty's earlier works, Parties Elsewhere, History of Loss, Love, Saving Skin, has deepened with his engagement with the 12th century tradition of Nirgun poetry, especially that of Gorakhnath. This emerges clearly in his recent film, Shoonya Ghar, a meditation on mortality. Drawing on the concept of the Doha, the artist presents disparate images that coexist and create new meanings that bounce off and amplify each other. Through more than 21 solo shows in prestigious galleries across 17 countries, over 40 group exhibitions, 15 special projects, participation in 3 biennales, and curating the 2016 Kochi Museiris Biennale in India, Sudarshan Shetty is continually expanding the horizons of his art. Today, the urge in contemporary art is to forge a language that is universal, yet not divorced from its local nuances. "That's the space of mediation I'm talking about," he says. "To be able to understand the expectations and find the means of bridging the distance between disparate cultures." So, ladies and gentlemen, let's drop our fixed notions for a while and let the art of Sudarshan Shetty open up new, deeper meanings of our lives and the world around us through his film, a story, a song, and his slideshow presentation. We eagerly await your presentations.
We have amongst us another legend from this region, Professor Goswami. It is the beginning of our session in Punjab Lalit Kala Akademi. So to begin with his blessings, I think would be, you would all agree with me, a better idea. So I'll invite Professor Goswami to share his thoughts with us. Thank you, Professor Goswami.
देखिए मेरी क्या विशात है कि मैं इनसे पहले बोलूं या इनके साथ सामने बोलूं, लेकिन मुझे कहा गया था कि सुदर्शन शेट्टी आ रहे हैं, तो मैं आज की बजाय कल यहाँ हो के चला गया. मुझे गलत नोट किया मैंने, इतनी मेरी चाहत थी कि इनसे मिलूं. आई एम हैप्पी टू बी हियर एंड वेलकम टू चंडीगढ़. मुझे ये भी कहा गया कि अमृता शेरगिल के बारे में कुछ कहूँ, तो दो चार शब्द हैं. सुदर्शन के नाम से, उनका नाम तो खैर आप जानते ही हैं, विष्णु भगवान के हाथ में चार आयुध होते थे, हैं, उनमें एक सुदर्शन है जो चक्र है, तो बहुत कुछ कंकर करता है वो चक्र. लेकिन सुदर्शन का दूसरा मतलब ये है कि अच्छे दर्शन वाला, अच्छे दर्शन कराने वाला. एक पेंटर थे 18वीं सदी के, नैनसुख उनका नाम था. तो नैनसुख का मतलब क्या है? जो आंखों को तरावत दे, आंखों को ठंडक दे, नैनों को सुख दे. तो सुदर्शन शायद ऐसे हैं कि अच्छी चीज़ों के दर्शन कराते हैं, खुद दर्शन करते हैं. आई एम वेरी कीन टू सी वॉट एवर ही इज़ डन, के बारे में बहुत पढ़ा है, बहुत सुना है. एंड आई एम हैप्पी टू हैव द प्लेजर ऑफ being here at this moment. Amrita Sher-Gil ke bare mein, jinke bare mein zikr kar rahe the ki unki birth anniversary hai, bahut kuch likha ja sakta, ja chuka hai. Lekin do char cheeze aisi hain jo dhyan mein rakhne wali hain. Why do we honor people? Why is it that she comes back to our minds again and again? Why is it that we speak of her as an iconic figure? यूरोप में कोई उनको जानता है? आई डाउट इट. बहुत कम लोग यूरोप में उनकी बात करते होंगे, लेकिन हमारे यहाँ उनकी बात होती है, और सही है, वाजिब है, बिल्कुल अप्रोप्रिएट है कि उनकी बात यहाँ पे हों. क्योंकि वो क्या किया अमृता शेरगिल ने? अमृता शेरगिल बाहर से आई, वहाँ ट्रेनिंग ली, तरह तरह की चीज़ें सीखी, लेकिन जब यहाँ पर आई और यहाँ पर उन्होंने देखा कि एक हालात में आर्ट के अंदर एक जमूद सा है, एक चीज़ जमी हुई है, रुकी हुई है कहीं पे, तो ऐसे किसी चीज़ को खमीर लगाया जाता है. लाइक ए लीवनिंग एजेंट शी वॉज हेयर फॉर ए नंबर ऑफ ईयर्स. बहुत साल जी नहीं, गॉड सेंड्स फॉर दोज हुम ही लव्स, बहुत अर्ली बुला लेते हैं उनको. तो शी वॉज हार्डली इन हर 30s, आई थिंक शी जस्ट क्रॉस 30 व्हेन शी डाइड. लेकिन इतनी छाप छोड़ गई वो इस देश के ऊपर, इस देश के आर्ट के ऊपर, कि इवन पीपल हैव नेवर सीन एनीथिंग ऑफ इंडियन आर्ट, उनको दो नाम तो याद रहते होंगे, एक उनका और एक मकबूल फिदा हुसैन का. ताज्जुब होता है कि क्यों दो नाम ऐसे हैं जिन्होंने ऐसी छाप छोड़ी है पिछले बरसों में हमारे इसके ऊपर. लेकिन सही है, क्योंकि अमृता शेरगिल एक आज़ाद तबीयत औरत थी, सब जानते हैं. उनकी पर्सनल लाइफ के बारे में, उनकी पर्सनल लाइफ के बारे में लिखा जा चुका है बार बार, एक लाइब्रेरी क्रिएट हो चुकी है अमृता शेरगिल के बारे में. उनकी बहन, उनका जो बेटा विवान ने बेशुमार, बेहद, ला इंतहा काम किया है, ना उनके ऊपर, न सिर्फ अमृता के ऊपर बल्कि उनके फादर के ऊपर. और पढ़ने वाली चीज़ें, द लेटर्स शी राइट्स, द काइंड ऑफ सेंसिटिविटी शी हैड, द एक्स्ट्रॉर्डिनरी एबिलिटी टू पेनिट्रेट द सोल ऑफ इंडिया एट दैट पर्टिकुलर टाइम, हैविंग कम फ्रॉम अब्रॉड एंड सो ऑन, इज एक्स्ट्रॉर्डिनरी, एब्सोल्युटली एक्स्ट्रॉर्डिनरी. मेरे एक दोस्त थे काल खंडाला वाला, जो अब नहीं रहे हैं, काल खंडाला वाला इज एन एक्स्ट्रॉर्डिनरी मैन, बैरिस्टर थे, पायलट रहे वर्ल्ड वॉर में एंड सो ऑन, लेकिन टर्नड आउट टू बी एन आर्ट हिस्टोरियन ऑफ ग्रेट डिस्टिंक्शन. काल खंडाला वाला के साथ अमृता शेरगिल की बड़ी दोस्ती थी. इनफैक्ट देवर एटलीस्ट काल वॉज इन लव विद हर, शी वॉज प्रॉबली इक्वली इन लव विद हिम एंड सो ऑन. कॉरेस्पॉन्डेंस पढ़ने वाली है, क्या आँखें खुलती हैं, यानी कि एक तरह का चमक पैदा होती है आँखों में सिर्फ वो कॉरेस्पॉन्डेंस बिटवीन द टू ऑफ देम पढ़ के. ताज्जुब होता कि एक लड़की, मैं औरत नहीं कहूँगा, जो विदेश में थी वहाँ पढ़ी लिखी, अपनी फैमिली में तरह तरह की काम किए उसने, जो कुछ भी है, वहीं यहाँ पे आई तो कम्प्लीटली ओपन्ड हरसेल्फ अप टू द कल्चर ऑफ इंडिया, वेदर शी इज इन द साउथ और वेदर वो जो मेले पे औरतें जा रही हैं या पंजाब में बैठी हैं या उत्तराखंड में बैठी हैं और वहाँ पे लड़की, तीन लड़कियाँ बैठी हैं, हिल विमेन, हिल मैन एंड सो ऑन, एक्स्ट्रॉर्डिनरी आइकॉनिक फिगर्स एंड सो ऑन सो फोर्थ. तो व्हाई डू वी रिमेंबर हर? बिकॉज शी चेंज थिंग्स, बिकॉज शी बिकेम अ लीविंग एजेंट, बिकॉज शी वॉज अनरिलेंटिंग इन हर परसूट ऑफ ट्राइंग टू अंडरस्टैंड द स्पिरिट ऑफ इंडिया. हिंदुस्तानी जुबान बहुत कम बोलती थी, शायद थोड़ी बहुत आती होगी उनको, लेकिन हिंदुस्तान की आत्मा को समझने की, उसमें दाखिल होने की सलाहियत उसके अंदर थी. बार बार कहती हैं ये पसोली पेंटिंग जिनका भी हम जिक्र करते हैं, जिनके बारे में थोड़ा बहुत मैं जानता हूँ, पसोली पेंटिंग इम्पैक्टेड हर लाइक एनीथिंग, कि ये क्या रंग है, यानी कि मुसव्विर ने क्या बनाया है, किस तरह के रंग, चटखीले रंग नहीं है खाली, लेकिन रंगों का आपस में डायलॉग कैसे होती है, इस तरह की बातें वो काल खंडाला वाला को लिखती थी. शी डिड नॉट हैव ए बिग कलेक्शन ऑफ इंडियन पेंटिंग्स, लेकिन शी वॉज वेरी वेरी फॉन्ड ऑफ द अर्ली आर्ट ऑफ इंडिया, एंड दैट इज अ लेसन फॉर एवरी सिंगल इंडिविजुअल हु प्रैक्टिसेस आर्ट एट दिस पर्टिकुलर टाइम इन माई कंट्री. हम लोगों में एक एरोगेंस है कि द पास्ट इज नॉट रियली टू रेलेवेंट. फॉकनर ने ठीक कहा, द पास्ट इज नॉट ओनली पास्ट, इज नॉट डेड, बट इट इज नॉट इवन पास्ट, बिकॉज इट लिव्स विद अस एवरी मोमेंट ऑफ आवर लाइव्स. तो टू टर्न आवर बैक्स ऑन द अर्ली आर्ट ऑफ इंडिया, मैं बेच नहीं रहा हूँ किताबें, कुछ नहीं, अब मेरी किताबें बिक चुकी हैं, तो मैं सिर्फ ये कह रहा हूँ कि टू टर्न आवर बैक्स ऑन द अर्ली आर्ट ऑफ इंडिया एंड सी वॉट इट इज़ लाइक, उसमें क्या जान है, क्या सलाहियत है, किस तरह का काम लोग करते थे, क्या सोच थी, कहाँ तक वो छलांग लगा सकते थे, एंड लीप इन टू द डार्क एंड सो ऑन, इज क्वाइट एस्टॉनिशिंग. एंड वी आर एट आवर पेरिल इफ यू इग्नोर द अर्ली आर्ट ऑफ इंडिया एंड द स्ट्रेंथ ऑफ अमृता शेरगिल्स वर्क इन दिस कंट्री इज दैट. Is that essentially that? So when we celebrate her, जब उनका इज्जत से नाम लेते हैं, जब उनको याद करते हैं, या जैसे आज बर्थ एनिवर्सरी उनकी मनाई जा रही है, तो it is entirely appropriate that we remember a person who helped change things, help bring about an extraordinary change. क्या अमृता के बारे में, I'm sorry, मैं एक मिनट और लूँगा. मिर्ज़ा गालिब ने कहीं कहा है कि बख्शे है ज़ौक़े तमाशा रंगे गालिब, चश्म को चाहिए हर रंग में वाह हो जाना. जो ज़ौक़े तमाशा है, जो देखने का शौक़ है, वो रंगों को निखारता है, निकालता है आपके सामने. इसलिए आँख को चाहिए, अपनी आँख को कह रहे हैं, हर रंग में वाह हो जाना. वाह का मतलब वाह वाह नहीं है, वाह का मतलब खुल जाना. आँख को खुली रखना जो है निहायत ज़रूरी है. वेदर वी लुक एट द वर्क ऑफ सुदर्शन शेट्टी टुडे और अमृता शेरगिल डे बिफोर यस्टरडे और नयन सुख 250 years अर्लियर देन अस एंड सो ऑन, दिस इज द एसेंस ऑफ सीइंग. आई एज अ वेरी वेरी स्मॉल मेंबर ऑफ दिस पर्टिकुलर कम्युनिटी ऑफ पीपल हु टेक इंटरेस्ट इन द आर्ट्स एंड हैव probably some understanding of the arts and so on, I'm delighted that I have and honored that I have this opportunity to to pay tribute to Amrita. Also, I am delighted to have been asked to be here because the Punjab Lalit Kala Akademi now has the pleasure and the honor and the advantage of having somebody like Diwan Manna head this particular segment of the Punjab Arts Council. Because इन्होंने जो काम चंडीगढ़ ललित कला एकेडमी के लिए किया है वो लाजवाब है और मैं समझता हूँ कि पंजाब में जो कुछ हो आप हो या आप कांग्रेस हो या बीजेपी हो या मैं हूँ या कोई भी हो they will all look at the work of this particular arts council and the Lalit Kala Academy and the Sangeet Natak Academy and the Sahitya Academy with respect. With respect. This is what keeps our society alive. This is what we need to value. मेरे पास कहने को कुछ भी नहीं है और बहुत कुछ है तो मैं कुछ भी नहीं को मानता हुआ I will say I'm very grateful that I get this opportunity and may I welcome you Mr. Shetty again in our midst and congratulate the Lalit Kala Academy and the Punjab Arts Council for initiating these things. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Goswami. In fact, we, especially I, don't deserve as much praise as he's given us, but his blessings are always welcome. Now I invite Sudarshan. You all know Sudarshan is damn busy. पिछले 18 महीने से कितने कंट्रीज कितने बार ट्रैवल कर चुका है और दिन रात किस किस्म से कोची मुजरिस बियनाले को इसने अलग किस्म का रंग अलग किस्म का रूप जो दिया है वो आप सब जाके देखेंगे तो आपको एहसास होगा मार्च 29 तक ऑन है आप सब ज़रूर जाइएगा मैं सिर्फ कोची मुजरिस बियनाले को सेल नहीं कर रहा हूँ मैं एक आइडिया को सेल कर रहा हूँ जो इंडिया में बहुत देर से मिसिंग था जिसको बोस कृष्णाचार्य और उसके पार्टनर कोमू ने मिल के ऐसा एक रूप और ऐसी शेप दे दी है जिसमें अब इस तीसरे वर्जन में सुदर्शन शेट्टी ने जिस किस्म का रंग ये लाए हैं इनके काम के थ्रू आप देखेंगे इसकी पर्सनैलिटी की जो वर्सेटिलिटी है उसके अंदर से आपको झलक मिलेगी कि इस किस्म के कलाकार की इस किस्म की थिंकिंग की इस किस्म के विजनरी एक इंसान की ज़रूरत थी हमें जो इस किस्म की बियनाले का रंग रूप हमें दिखा सके सिर्फ बियनाले नहीं अभी हम इनका रंग रूप देखेंगे इनका काम देखेंगे उसके बाद बियनाले के बारे में भी बातें करेंगे और एक मेमोरेबली आइटम्स भी हमने कुछ तैयार किए हैं इन्होंने हमें कॉपीराइट्स दिए हैं हालांकि इनके पूरे दुनिया में बड़े बड़े जो गैलरीज हैं म्यूजियम्स हैं उनके साथ कॉपीराइट्स के इन्होंने फिर भी हमें अपने काम को हमारे मेमोरेबली आइटम्स के ऊपर रिप्रोड्यूस करने की परमिशन दी है फ्री ऑफ कॉस्ट वी आर ग्रेटफुल टू यू सुदर्शन एंड ऑल्सो टू विवान सुंदरम आज अमृता जी के जन्मदिन के ऊपर उन्होंने ही इज़ ऑल्सो गिवन अस परमिशन फ्री ऑफ कॉस्ट टू प्रोड्यूस मेमोरेबेलिया सोवेनियर्स विद अमृता शेरगिल्स इमेजेस विच आर इन हिज एंड हिज सिस्टर नवीनास कलेक्शन
फर्स्टली थैंक यू दीवान जी फॉर दिस प्रिविलेज ऑफ बीइंग एबल टू शो माय वर्क एंड इट्स एंड थैंक यू टू पंजाब ललित कला अकेडमी एंड it's an honor that we have with us today Professor B.N. Goswami with us and he's one person I've been wanting to meet for a long time and this seems to be, I mean, what better situation than this to be able to meet him finally. I've been last 10 minutes, I've been hearing all these praises. I hope there'll be a day when I deserve all the praises that have been showered upon me. To start with my work, you know, I'm going to show you four exhibitions basically that happened in the span of last 3 years, four solo shows that I've done. I start with the show that was made in 2013. Before that, I would like to make a case for the idea of, as an artist, for an idea of making and dissemination. So what does making mean for an artist, you know? What are those compulsions that drives an artist to make objects is one thing, and then where does it go? Who's looking at it? You know, who is your audience? And how does it get looked at, or how does it get interpreted constantly? Is a question that I've been dealing with for quite a while now and thinking about it, you know, right from the time that I came out of an art school, which was 1985, and also kind of growing up in a household, you know, my father was a Yakshagana artist, and like some of the things that Professor Goswami talked about the idea of that is there a way of, you know, looking forward or trying to understand our own everyday situation or contemporary situations without having to look back. I think that it's very, very important for us to understand who we are, to be able to know who we were, to be able to understand who we are. So a lot of my work kind of slowly started getting into this mediation between how I looked at the world, or how naturally we looked at the world, and the way we were taught to make art, if they were to be separate things. And, you know, coming out of the art school, I started going to museums and, you know, galleries, and started to realize that that there was this huge gap between what was happening within the museum space and outside of it. And it referred back to my own education, which was at loggerheads with how I had grown up with all these stories and songs that were told in the house, or sung in the house, or performed in the house, with my father. And, you know, there would be always, you know, people coming in, and there would be these discussions about, you know, their aesthetic choices, to, you know, how an argument could be constructed within all the narratives that, you know, epic narratives that they were performing. So I think going back to the making, why do we need to make objects is the one of the first questions. And if that were to be a personal compulsion, that we need to make objects, or we need to put out objects that are there, the question is, what is its function, you know, in a situation where we deal with so many images, you know, not only in terms of visual images, also in terms of, you know, conceptual images that we kind of have to deal with on an everyday basis. So I started looking at a question that, is there a vacuum within making of something? Is there a vacuum within our own gathering of objects around us? So can we include, I mean, there was that vacuum, you know. I think, you know, the way we gather objects around ourselves in certain ways reflects upon our own sense of mortality, that our own sense of biological waning of the body in many ways. Like, you look at, you know, for example, you know, to kind of reflect upon things that are, like, for example, the idea of a cenotaph or a monument, or even this hall which is named after someone, that there is a sense that there is a stubbornness, that a human stubbornness not to forget or extend our own biological lives, so to say. And also there is a vacuum within that kind of, this exercise in itself could be meaningless, because, you know, you cannot stop this ongoing mortality that we live with every day. So my question was, can we include both those positions at the same time? In my case, as an artist, having spent a considerable time in making something, putting all that energy and time into making something, can I include the fact that there is also an emptiness within that? There is also a futility within that. So can both those positions be mutually inclusive and not exclusive? That can be seen as not separate. And I think there is something very, very essential to the way we look at the world that is multiple in nature, and that multiplicity is not seen in binaries or in separations, that they need to be seen as a part of singular flow of, so to say, life in general. So one of the first shows that I'm going to show Sorry, there's a mistake in the title. Every Broken Moment, Piece by Piece. That was the show I had in Delhi at a gallery that I work with. So one of the leitmotifs for the show was a film that I'm going to show here. I'm trying to show here, which is just 10 minutes. And so there are these set of objects. So I'm also playing out the idea of mortality in a kind of very, very literal manner. That it's not, you know, like they are seemingly old looking objects. So I buy this lot of these, you know, modern Chinese pottery that kind of at some point of time, that point of time, invaded the market. And, you know, like there was a huge market apparently for these kind of pots. They're all new, newly made, they're not old. And they're all screen printed on these ceramic pots, and I would see them everywhere in Bombay markets being sold. So what we did was we bought a lot of them, and then I broke it in the studio. And while breaking it, it's very hard to break it in a way that you can really control it, and it would break in any manner. But before breaking it, you know, we made like these pots in wood, which is exactly the replica of these vases or pots. And then after having broken it, we mapped the cracks, and then it was traced onto the wooden pots, and then we brought them together. So it was also kind of playing out this whole notion of loss and an effort at, you know, bringing it back into life, or back into shape in this case. So you can see the detail of it now. Then this is a whole suite of a set of, you know, I think three tea sets, or one dinner set and two tea sets. Each of the piece was broken and then kind of brought back to, so to say, back to life with wood. So now the wood that is being used here is recycled from, you know, like I collect a lot of wood. I've been collecting a lot of wood for last 10 years. You know, I have like a collection of 900 odd pillars right now, and, you know, about 1,000 doors. It's a way of, you know, bringing all those unknown or untold stories into the work. So what you see as a part which is newly kind of constructed is old, but the thing that is seemingly old, which was the pots, are newly bought. So it's also kind of playing with these notion of opposites and bringing them together in a way that it becomes a part of the same space of experience. Even the pedestal is made out of old doors. So you see all the scratches and the paint, the layers of paint, everything is very, very evident. This is again, you know, like there are two panels, and one it's made to look like marble on the left. And the right side is made out of old doors and, you know, old wood pieces that I found in the second-hand market. And there's a line which is like there is a story. Each one has a story on it that talks about something of the past, that seemingly something of the past, but it's like entirely fictional. And it's like an experience that is narrated breathlessly, because it's without punctuation. So the whole story runs, I mean, it's like about, I don't know how many words, there are 75 or 76 words without a full stop or a comma. It runs like in a singular line. And each word is etched into the wood here. And then these three pieces are, you know, like out of my collection of old broken furniture that I make. And they've been stuck to the wall as a part of, in a way that it becomes a part of that memory recall, or, you know, kind of, and it's like rendered entirely dysfunctional in a way that it's also questioning the notion of an object within a gallery space. I don't know if there was a way to... Yeah, I wrote them, but I don't remember them now, so I can't even read it. Can you? It's hard. And then I collected a lot of shards of in the markets, shards of you know, ceramic of China, basically. And then there's one cup in the middle, which keeps moving around with a mechanical device underneath. And this was more like a an object from a temple space, so it becomes like, you know, it has a sense of being sacred, but it's made to look old. And this, as you would know, they are like, it's a like much more obvious kind of interpretation of the same idea, that these are pickle jars, and again, they are broken in the same manner and the same process being used. And, you know, we use old wood to complete the forms. This, as you would know, it's like a, it's a part of a death ritual that that the pot is hung outside the house with a red cloth. So the pot is made out of wood, it's not real. So and this is a part of the ritual that kind of, you know, disappears after the 13th day of the mourning. And here it is kind of, in a way, there is, it's made to be permanent because it's a sculptural object now. It adorns a collector's home in Miami right now. I don't know how they look at it. And there are two busts without heads with a glass of water which evaporated through the time of the exhibition. Which apparently 2 months it kind of became half a glass. Can you see the glass properly? It's a bit out of focus, I think. Is it?
We can see.
So this is just a simple wall constructed, made out of recycled wood again, which kind of compresses a mountain-like structure at the back, which is made out of fiberglass. This is again a very tall structure. It's about 12 feet or 11 and a half feet high, and again made out of old wood and doors, basically. And inside, there's a bulb that hangs down, almost touching the floor. And if you can read, you can't read it actually. There is a, so I've inserted the words, there's a line which says, "God envies my mortality," at the bottom, with the same type of wood. So it's paint, it's using all the paint finishes that I got on the wood as it is. And up you see that, you know, it's a part of the dome, inside of the dome, which follows the Islamic design, you know, the brick structure of technique of making a dome. Some installation views. So now I'll show you the film for 10 minutes. It's shot 3 times actually separately, but it's a single channel projection, but there are 3 parts to it. It was shot in a building that was soon going to be demolished, and it was a chawl. You know, chawls are like, more and more chawls are disappearing now in Bombay, as you would know that, you know, like it's making way for, you know, these high-rise residential structures now. And chawls were made, like most of them were made in the 1920s when there was like industrial boom, the textile industry boom. People came from all over, came to work, and these were tenements made for for them, and it's like one room tenements basically. And and more often than not, it would have a very kind of elaborate exterior, and it's always in memory of someone. So this is like a little film that I made called Waiting for Others to Arrive. Yeah, so going back, this is another show in 2012 called The Pieces Earth Took Away, which was in Vienna. Yeah, so here what I was trying to do was, you know, kind of invent my own rituals of death, five different rituals through making of objects, really. So this is a series that, I mean, this is the first one of the series that I did in various parts of the cities. Here I am standing in front of the newly, the new Pride of Bombay, which is the bridge that links between Worli and, so it became like sort of an icon of Bombay, of the new Bombay. And it was like published everywhere. So this was like very appropriate to do. So I perform a part of a death ritual out there. And what we do is, I throw this pot, and that exactly the same pot has been reconstructed and becomes a part of the exhibition, which is displayed in front of the series of these three photographs. Yeah, here it is. So exactly the same pot you will see in real. So it's also playing with, you know, this notion of the representation, in this case, you know, using photography as a medium. So how does, you know, things remove itself from so-called reality when we use a certain medium to, you know, represent something, is the question that I was dealing with as well at the same time. And how, you know, especially in terms of photograph, how photograph can replace the idea of reality, so to say, of its the situation that it is shot. How does it, you know, kind of remove itself and becomes, replaces the memory of the real situation in some ways. So here you see the broken pot being remended. So it's also an effort at, you know, bringing it back to life. But the futility is inbuilt into it because you cannot really mend it. You see a lot of cracks, and there are like missing pieces in the pot as well. And then there is another, so this was like a inversion of a, say, so to say, a design of a cenotaph, a very simple design. The dome is inverted and it holds a whole mound of rice. And, you know, rice is something that is used in many rituals. So I was thinking a lot about, you know, various rituals of death that I could use in my own ways to be able to reconstruct it, reimagine it in various ways. To be able to mediate it with an expectation of a contemporary art space like this, where I was showing this. So there is a mound of rice which kind of keeps trickling down. And it takes about 7 days for it to kind of come. And so it kind of replaces the mound on top that gets replaced at the bottom at the end of 7 days. Seven, I mean, there's no significance for the number seven here. I mean, it just so happened that it took 7 days. This is another cenotaph, and then we had, I have this hole in the, my cursor is not here. Actually, in the middle of the ceiling, there's a hole that has a stream of water that comes down and goes into a hole here. So there's a constant recycling of water that is happening within this cenotaph, design for a cenotaph. So I've kind of, you know, use my own imagination to, you know, embellish it. And it's also, you know, like I've been studying, especially at that point of time, I was studying a lot of scale, or a lot of architecture of cenotaph, of, you know, death memorials, so to say. And yeah, this swan's crown comes from elsewhere, actually, you know, like I wanted to make a swan there. This comes from a poetry by Kabir, Ur Jayega Hans Akela. So it's like a representation. So it's like, you know, using, I mean, it's like when I make like these architectural images, I mean, this is the one of the first architectural object that I've ever made. I try to keep it very, very secular in nature, that, you know, like each, these pillars are from possibly from, you know, Rajasthani Hindu temples. The dome is evidently, you know, an Islamic dome. Not only literally like that, you know, like taking it from various sources, whether it's south or north, and making it extremely secular that you cannot really place it to be from a certain region. That was the idea. And then there are these 13 doors, which represents 13 portals that the soul needs to pass. You know, there's a belief that, you know, after having dead, it takes 13 days for the soul to kind of find its way to wherever it's supposed to be. And there are 13 portals. So I buy these old doors and I make a set of pieces of old doors. I mean, in some cases, you know, like where you see these, they are part of broken doors. There are two pieces that you see, which is very obvious, three pieces maybe. And then what I did was, again, I pasted a line, which is like a breathless line, which runs across, which is again telling a story as if it's from the past, but it's entirely fictional and, you know, cooked up by me. I think there might be a slide with the words here. Can you read this? So yeah, that was the last show, and next, I'm just kind of jumping years right now. 2016, that was last year, in fact. In January, I showed it in NGMA for the first time, and then traveled to a couple of other places. I mean, it was part of Sydney Biennale, and then Incheon Biennale. This was based upon very, very particularly about upon a poetry written in the 12th century AD by this great poet called Goraknath. And so Goraknath, Kabir, I mean, as most of you would know Kabir's work, Kabir's poetry, and Kabir's seemed to have, like in a doha, in one of his dohas, as kind of considers Goraknath as his guru. And as most people believe that Goraknath was the first one to invent the form of doha, which is not couplets, but it's two-liners. Very often than not, in a doha, what happens is the first line establishes an image, and the second line comes up with a counter image. Not a counter, necessarily counter image, but a diverse image. So I was talking to someone who is a great, you know, scholar of bhakti poetry, and she also happened to be a teacher in English in Chennai. So she says that, I mean, she teaches English poetry in the university, and she says that when you, like, there is a kind of strategy of deconstruction to be able to teach poetry, that you deconstruct the poetry to be able to teach or make it understood. But she says that if you kind of do that to a doha, it loses its meaning completely. Although they are so diverse in nature, in each line, could be, you know, in many cases diverse, that come from various sources and creates like very, very diverse images. In this case, there's this poetry goes, Shoonya Ghar Shahar, Shahar Ghar Basti, Kaun Sota Kaun Jaage Hai. So if I were to just analyze in my humble way or translate in a very loosely, I mean this was never translated well in English, that's another thing, you know. I was looking for a translation of this in English everywhere, and I had a friend call Arvind Krishna Mehratra, who is a great translator of Kabir and, you know, scholar of bhakti poetry, and he says that this poet, I mean, he said to her that this poetry was not possible to be translated, and it's impossible to find a translation for this. So loosely, in my own way, if I were to translate it, it says, empty is this fort, empty is this city, empty is this house, it's empty everywhere, that's the first line. And the second line goes, who's asleep and who's awake? So if everything is empty, where is the question of someone being awake or asleep? So this is the magic that I wanted to kind of crack, and this kind of resonated with me in many ways, the way I have been kind of, you know, growing up with poetry, whether it's South Indian Yakshagana or, you know, lot of the poetry, ancient poetry, look at Sangam poetry, I mean these kind of, you know, strategy was common to a lot of the way we looked at the world. When I say we, I'm not making a distinction between the East and the West. I think, you know, that would be too simplistic a distinction to make, because, you know, I think there is a lot of my education was also in, say, you know, like personally speaking, in Western history of art, and my way of looking back at where I came from. So at times it all seems like a big, you know, complex mass, but at other times it also seems at loggerheads. So my effort is at kind of what are those points of mediation, you know, like if I were to operate within the system that is governed by a Western history or Western canons, how do I kind of introduce what I need to say or where I come from? So there are points of mediations that I believe are possible, and I'm still working on it. I mean, I don't know how successful I am. So anyway, going back to the poetry, I was very, very fascinated by the architectural structure of the poetry and even all of the poetry. It goes on to say that Jal bich kamal, kamal bich kaliyan, bhamar basna leta hai, is nagri ke das darwaje, jogi pheri nit leta hai. So there is like a lot of architectural images. I mean, just imagine, you know, like it's also to wonder, you know, like what is the idea of a city when Gorakhnath was writing it in 12th century? What kind of city was it? I mean, were there cities like the way we kind of perceive the cities today? All those questions remain questions, you know. I think it became a part of my work in some ways, that I started, you know, building this set of four buildings, and over the period of 18 months when I was building it, I was also simultaneously working on a script for a film that could be kind of shot in these buildings. So the one of the first images that, the first image that you saw, which was on the flex out there, was a shot from a display in China when it went for the Biennale there. And all the wood, I mean, it was entirely built with wood, and all the wood came from my collection of recycled material that I've been collecting from old dismantled structures in and around Bombay or elsewhere. So each of these pillars were like, you know, reclaimed and so we built this complex of four buildings in my studio, and which was eminently dismantleable. And the fact that it is dismantleable is also evident in the film. So we took it to an abandoned quarry very close to Bombay near the hill station called Lonavala. And there was this cavity made out of mountain by having the stone being taken away to build elsewhere. So this was like a symbolic reclaiming of that space. And we went and rebuilt that whole structure there, all the four structures there. By the help of five people that worked with me, they're all there in the picture right now, helped me make this building. And then we had actors and there's a musician. So it was like, you know, using three conventions of cinema, the narrative, the performative part of it, the making of the set, and the music. They are all played out on the screen, actually, at the same time. So I was like, you know, we quite didn't know, and you, like, when you look at the film, you quite don't know what the relationship is between the characters or between the scenes, but there is some sort of thread that kind of binds them together, and it kind of opens up for a enormous speculative space between those moments or between the relationship of the actors. They play out that little, their little scene. So it, like, it's also kind of drawing from the conventions of dramatics, and like, you know, the music and the performance and the building of the set. And I wish I could show you this film. It's too long. It's 60 minutes. It became 60 minutes. We were like hoping it would be 25-30 minutes, but as I was editing it, it became a 60-minute film. So these are some of the shots while we were shooting it. We had a lot of performers. This was shown at the NGMA then. So we had like those four structures that you see as soon as you enter, and you go into a little black room where you watch the film, and then come out and maybe see the structures differently or become a part of the whole scene in some ways that was in the film. So within the structure, if we go back, so there is that big room here, there, at the right side, and you enter through there, and it's like a long corridor, and like a very idiosyncratic, the architecture is entirely idiosyncratic, because it was developed through my writing of the script. So as the script demanded a certain scene, then we kind of kept, you know, adding or removing or, you know, modifying the structures in various ways. So it became like entirely idiosyncratic, but it's still, you know, it's something that looks old, but it's not old, it's like a newly designed building, but with old material. And at the end of the corridor, you have a big room that replicates a one-room tenement, like the chawl, that I grew up in, one of those. It's very similar to the area that we had. Our whole family kind of, I grew up like my first 10 years of my life. I have a very vivid memory of that. So I recreated that with a lot of refound material, utensils and various objects that are inside. So the old sewing machine which my sister used to use. This is like somewhat of a cupboard that we used to have. And there's a little transistor. So there's a lot of scenes which were also kind of played out within this room. And there was, at the end, you'll see a little bicycle there. So there was a room with, this is the room, and then it's like a incomplete room on top. So there is a room full of objects that were used during the filming of it. This was a display shot at the Inchon. These are just people, visitors out there. And these are the stills from the films, the film. So the film starts with it being just with the footprint of the house, and then over the period of the time, the house gets built. Okay, now to song, a story. Do I have, am I on time, or do I have some time to speak about it?
We never fixed any time.
Okay. So this was a story, you know, I was asked by Rolls-Royce to make a work, Rolls-Royce Art, what is it called, Rolls-Royce Art, Art Programme, Rolls-Royce Art Programme asked me to make a work. They commissioned one, it's not really a commission because the work belongs to me, it's not asked by them, they just kind of finance one project of one artist every year, and last year they asked me to make a film, make a work. So I came up with this idea of making this film, which I had heard as a child, I mean as a student, on a black and white TV. This was A.K. Ramanujam, you know, retelling this story, a famous Kannada folk tale. And this story remained with me for a very, very long time. So it just came upon me that, you know, this is an opportunity to kind of, you know, make a film out of that. So the story goes like this. There's a woman who has a story and a song, a story to tell and a song to sing, but she never does tell the story, neither does she sing the song. So the story and the song inside her decide to teach her a lesson. That they are very, very kind of, they've been waiting to be out there in the world through this woman, but she wouldn't let her, let them out. So the story and the song, decide to teach her a lesson. And one day when she dozes off to sleep, waiting for her husband to come back home in the evening, they ride on her breath and come out of her body, and they wander about, and the story becomes a man's umbrella, and the song becomes a pair of man's shoes, and they lay outside the doorstep, and the husband returns home, and he sees this man's umbrella and shoes, and he's very suspicious, and he wakes her up, and he kind of, they have an argument, and she doesn't know about it, and she doesn't know anything, and he just leaves the house in anger, and he goes to the Temple of Lights. So what I did was, so let me finish the story first. He goes to the Temple of Lights, and all the lights of the village, after having been put off in their respective homes, come to this temple to chat. And he's overhearing this chat, and the light from his house comes late, and all the other lights ask, what happened, why are you late? So the light says, narrates the whole story. So he suddenly realizes his mistake, that, you know, and he's like, very, very surprised that he didn't know that his wife had a story to tell and a song to sing, and he runs back home and wakes her up again, which is now very late in the night, and says, why did you never tell me that you had a story to tell and a song to sing? And the wife says, what story, what song? Because she's lost both the story and the song. So the moral of the story is, if you have a story to tell, you must tell, and if you have a song to sing, you must sing. So this is my story and the song that I'm trying to sing. So I think, you know, it's also kind of, at a fundamental level, it also talks about what I started with in some ways, that the need to make something, you know, where does it come from, you know, what is the function of it, all kind of gets addressed in this one story. So what we did was, I shot this story twice. I made this film twice, and it's a two-way projection, two-channel projection, but here, for the convenience, it's one channel. We put it together in one channel, and it's told twice with a certain variation, two different locations, same actors, same set. So we built two sets. One is a house, and one is the House of Lights. One is a private space, and one is a secular place, a public place, so to say. I'll show you the film, I guess. Yeah, these are the two structures. This is one structure, which is the House of Lights that we made. It took us like almost 9 months to make this. This is the house.
Thank you, Sudarshan. Thank you for taking us through such a wonderful journey of the self and the other. We had our own Baba Bulle Shah, who also questioned, you know, Bulleya ki jana main kaun? And you are making us look not only at the world from a different perspective, but within ourselves. And this is what an artist's role is. It has been throughout the centuries. We may or may not actually recognize, but we have had our, you know, poets, as he mentioned, the Hargun poetry, and then Kabir, and, you know, many others within, as he mentioned, you know, a couplet or a doha. There's coexistence of the two different worlds, which are maybe at odds with each other, or at contrast with each other, or merging into each other. And there are certain kinds of, you know, realities or, you know, notions which are beyond our comprehension, which remain beyond our comprehension always, which are never understood. And that is the story of probably human life. That is this sense of wonder which keeps us going. Now we are open to the question answer session.
Not exactly a question, just an observation. And maybe you can throw some, you know, add something to what I perceive. Your works, there are a lot of, let's say, you know, broken pieces in the beginning. And then there was an element of light as well. So broken and light, somewhere the relationship between the two, how would you showcase that? I mean, I'm sure we've been able to understand that, but if you could just maybe say something more on the relationship between broken and light. I see a very strong element of light in, you know, how the works are showcased.
Light, you meant light?
Light, yeah. I mean, basically in the works, yeah.
Uh-huh.
I mean, in the whole commentary, in the narrative, would like to hear from you, the relationship between the broken pieces, like in the beginning, in the first presentation, and the element of light together. Like there is one saying, I'm not able to remember the exact words, broken, and that's where the light gets in. So is that something which maybe somewhere you're trying to project somewhere in your works?
Yeah, I'm interested in this whole idea of the seeming opposites, you know, that there are many, many positions that are available to us that could be seen as in opposites. And can we kind of...
Is there a way to kind of bring it together?
Is there a way to bring it together in a way that they are not seen in separations?
My question is related to your recent work, A Song, Story. That's a two-channel video, and it's been shot twice, as you said. Looking at the whole video, I want to understand why was it shot twice at two different locations, yet it had the same message?
It's to accentuate on, it's like playing on this idea of a narrative that comes from, you know, wherever. And also it's quite interesting that, you know, like, I mean, if you look at, say, Hindustani classical music, and, you know, someone is rendering a bandish that may have been written, like, you know, 200 years ago, that was maybe set 200 years ago. And it's only when a performer kind of makes it her or his own that it comes to life, alive. So there is a lot of stress on retelling, and retelling in a way that it becomes one's own. Just to play on that retelling, you know, just we had to make it twice. How do I retell it again? And if you notice it carefully, it is retold three times because, you know, this right in the beginning, the singer and his disciple, he sings out the, you know, whole story before the film actually, just about when the film begins. And then you see the story again. So it's again another playing out of that retelling.
Four times. He told us before.
Yes. I find that interesting. And it's also kind of, you know, question the notion of proprietary, that, you know, like it comes from somewhere and you interpret and make your own for that time being. And even this story and the song, the story about the story and the song, that, you know, like it kind of resides in her for a, you know, a limited number of or days or time, you know, limited time, that it has to leave her if she doesn't come out of with it. So it's like it's playing with this also this notion which is so connected to, it seems so important, you know, the whole idea of proprietary within, like, you know, if you look at the contemporary art world, that the name becomes at times much bigger than the work itself, the name of the artist.
You've worked extensively with wood in your career, and you also said that you've been collecting wood for, you know, many years. So what is it about wood as a medium that you're so drawn to?
This is something that's easily recyclable, so it's also available in the market. You know, I can't think of, you know, many other things that are recyclable in the same manner, that I can kind of do something else out of it also, you know, which is just incidental that I use wood and it kind of, and every scratch and a lot of the wood, you know, like I quite wonder, like there's like literally stories that open up, you know, like, you know, who would have used this, you know, there are names on the, scratched on the wood at times, and it comes with nameplates at times, you know, like saying BALLB, you know, so and so, in, out, So it, like each piece of the wood would have, you know, like something to explore and some case to be made in terms of, you know, where it comes from. That becomes a part of my work, conceptually speaking and symbolically speaking, even. That it becomes a part of my work and, you know, all those stories get included in some way or the other, you know, knowingly, unknowingly, whether you know about the story or not, it becomes a part of the thing. So this takes me to, you know, very interesting distinction that this great filmmaker Mani Kaul makes. You know, I mean, I don't know how many of you know about Mani Kaul, but I think he's one of the greatest artists that we produced, you know, to my mind, in the recent times. I think, you know, he's talking about his teacher, you know, Ritvik Ghatak's films in this particular interview, and he makes the distinction between drama and epic. So he says that epic is something that includes other worldviews. It's not a singular narrative. It's like a multiple narrative that is at play. So I'm interested in, like, you know, in that kind of mode of operation. I think it, which is very, very natural for us to understand that. Again, it kind of, you know, carries that multiplicity as one, you know, it becomes one story, but it includes so many other stories, and, you know, it's a part of the way we kind of grow up in some ways, or, you know, or we the way we look at the world even. You know, that it's not a singular reality that we believe in. The reality is in multiple. So the question is, can I go to the extent of saying that the truth is multiple in nature? So if truth were to be multiple in nature, then there's no singular truth. All of them can be read as lies. So it's both those positions are possible within that same idea. Yes.
In the film, this guy takes a long walk. And one walk is through the village, through sounds. And the other walk is a very lonely walk. And the one who takes the lonely walk, he returns drenched. So is he the one who is transformed? And what are, I mean, these are multiple realities you are talking about. But how do you interpret it?
In as many ways you can interpret it. this is one option, you know, then one option you have. I mean, is there another story that can be read out of it? That's the distinction between the idea of singular narrative or drama and making of, trying to, you know, kind of allude to the idea of epic in that sense. Yeah.
My question relates to, doesn't relate to what we've just seen, but I just wanted to know, there are these very interesting excavations going on in Muziris. Have you ever explored the possibility of basing your art somewhere in that scenario?
No, not yet. but yeah, I've been very interested in the excavations, particularly in Muziris, actually.
Yes.
That Nagapattinam area, and because of my engagement with the Biennale, that I had the opportunity to go there many times and, you know, be in the museums. And they, apparently there are like slight digression here. there are like 2 million, more than 2 million Chinese relics were found there. And also, like, I was quite surprised to know from someone, one of the, you know, curators there, that Cochin literally means little China in Malayalam. And, you know, these kind of layering and these kind of transference, you know, like, I mean, this could be China and this is also India, this is Kochi, is something that interests me even in my own work. So the idea of, you know, identity becomes kind of constantly blurred. Especially with the, you know, because there's like such a huge maritime history that this land has. So it kind of layered, you know, that you find, like, you know, there were these stones lying outside David Hall, one of the locations of the building. So I was like always wondering what this stone was meant for. It was almost like, I guess it was a size of like 6x3 and it's really heavy, you know. And it's apparently, it came with the Dutch ships to keep, because they would come empty, you know, like empty ships, to keep it, like, you know, in balance and for better sailings. And then they would just dump this in these ports and take back spice or whatever that is, you know, black pepper. And like, you know, all this kind of exchange, that is very, very evident, you know, walking through Kochi. I mean, in that sense, it's like almost like a microcosm of India. This also kind of, you know, I'm interested in this idea of transference, that, you know, you constantly see these layers of history. That, you know, for example, there is a temple out there which is called Kapiri Temple. So Kapiris are the Portuguese slaves. They were brought from Africa and they became a part of the community. So there's a huge Kapiri, you know, community in that area. And there's a temple. So what they did was, when they were, like, the Dutch were invading, the Portuguese were running away. So they buried all their wealth and they buried these slaves as well, along with the wealth, to protect the wealth.
I want to come back to the use of two or three channels. You know, I mean, in terms of, say, the narrative strategy, it obviously works because it tells the same story from multiple angles and so on and so forth, which is one of your concerns. But in purely visual terms, I mean, not in terms of the narrative, but in purely visual terms, it does another thing, and I wonder if that's your intention. It actually decenters the gaze of the viewer. Mm-hmm. You know, when you have one channel, you know, there's definitely something that's the focus of the frame. Mm-hmm. And that's very deliberate on the part of the cinematographer or whoever is creating that visual. You know, what is to be put in the center, what is in the margins, and how the gaze will move from the center to the margin and back. But when you have two channels or three channels running simultaneously, it subverts that, right? I mean, I was sitting here when I was watching this, and there were three channels in the first case and two in the other. You know, which one I'm looking at becomes rather random and chaotic, right? So, at one level, you're trying to tell the same story from multiple angles, but in purely visual terms, I think you're also forcing the viewer not to take any one of those two or any one of those three stories in a singular way.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so I thought that there is that kind of strategy, whether intentional or, you know, spontaneous.
Yeah, one of the intention was to kind of also try and play with the, like, I mean, even in the earlier video that you saw, the intention was to create these three screens, split screens, is to kind of play with the notion of time, to confuse in terms, I mean, like, you know, not, I mean, not like to break into that linearity that cinema, you know, it's like comes with such a condition of linearity. So it was to break that, you know, you don't know what happened before what and what is going to happen next, or, you know, so you play with three kind of notions of, if I were to say, past, present and future, you know, tenses. So that was the thing. So I was also very aware when I was making this two channel video was that it will make you want to look at it, I mean, possibly and hopefully that it would want to make you look at it another time. So it's another retelling again, or three times to be able to try and, you know, to gather what exactly is happening in terms of action inside.
I just wanted to know about, is this film, like, it shows many influences of Mani's work, long takes, that poetical approach to the film and that use of classical music to it. It very much reminded of Mani's work. I just would like to, is this inspired or is that approach, how does it work, please?
Absolutely, I'm sure there is a lot of influence and I've been a big admirer of Mani Kaul for a long time, so that would have some resonance in what I do. I mean, even if I had a little resonance of that, I'd find myself fortunate.
It's really heartening, it's really for us encouraging that people are even sitting in the gallery for this kind of a cinema. So how far we have traveled from Mani Kaul's days to your days, in which things which are seen to be, you know, kind of difficult to comprehend and understand, but there are people now willing to invest their time and thought and resources into trying to understand those nuances of this world around us.
The significance of the laughter in this film, in the end, what was it that you were trying to convey?
It's the first attempt was, like, I mean, if I were to rationalize it, I mean, there's not always a rational answer. It just something seems correct, you know, like, if you were to ask me why she is levitating, I don't really have one. I mean, I could lie to you every day. I mean, come up with a different lie every day, you know. Or maybe not lie, you know, different interpretation every day. But I think, you know, like this effort at, like, you know, looking for things that would kind of create parallel worlds and worlds, and where do they meet in terms of image and sound, is something that I'm constantly kind of trying to look at. So if you see, except for the singer singing, all the sounds are seemingly outside of the film, but they have to kind of, you know, it's only in the making that you kind of, even if it is from the outside, it's something that kind of comes close to it. You know, it's both. So it's a constant experimentation with that. So it took me a long time, you know, working on the sound, because, you know, the first sound was to kind of, you know, idea was to kind of, or a response was to kind of, in terms of footsteps, you know, following the footsteps and, you know, doing all the kind of incidental things that we were recording on location. But a lot of these sounds which are there are also, I mean, we found a school there, a school where the teacher was teaching. I said, you know, just randomly, just record this, let's see, you know, if we can use it. And I think it worked well toward the end. We actually had a song which was, the song again was written by a lyrics writer, and then we went to Raja Kale and got him to sing, compose and sing it. So it comes from, like, it's a Karnataka story, it's written like quasi bridge bhasha style, and you know, so there's a lot of kind of these kind of interventions from various places. So it kind of creates a certain kind of layer for me, even in terms of making it. That was interesting. Yeah.
Yeah. I have a question which is actually related to the Kochi Biennale, because I saw it like about 2 weeks back. I was there in Kochi and I went specially from here to see it. And I just wanted to compliment you, being the curator of the Biennale, that it was absolutely mind-blowing and it was like fantastic. And I really didn't expect that scale of work. And I had a couple of questions which came to me, apart from the diversity of what was on show over there, part of the installations, the videos, the, you know, the art and everything, was the venues that were selected. And whether it was the Cabral Yard or whether it was the Anand warehouse where Bharat Sikka's photographs was displayed, I think each venue was absolutely unique. And down to the smell of spices at the Anand warehouse. So I was just wondering that how did you even think of all those venues and how did it all, I mean, it was like just about, I've never seen anything like that in my life. So I just wanted to know that, how did you?
Yeah, I mean, it's, like a lot of the venues have been there with the Biennale since the first edition. It's not that I found it, it's Bose and Riaz who, and none of the locations are owned by the Biennale. They are all privately owned, and we have to kind of, every single edition, they have to go back to the owners and get it. And particularly the Aspinwall House, if I were to talk about it, was, yeah, it's, we just got it like 4 months before the Biennale, and by the time we enter, I mean, it's like, it goes into complete disuse after an edition, and then, like, when I was walking, there are, like, the grass was higher than, you know, us. And it's like nothing short of a miracle how it's come together the way it looks today, you know. It's just the energy of those people who work with the Biennale, you know. There's like a lot of young people. There's a staff of 120 people who work at the like, you know, for 3 months prior to the Biennale to make it happen. And it's quite a miracle how it's all come together, you know, even to my mind. Because, you know, a week before the opening, I was like, you know, everyone was screaming at each other and there was nothing up. And I wouldn't believe that, you know, I couldn't believe come 12th of December, everything was, 95% of the works were up, you know. So
there was a very elaborate use of props, architectural props, backdrops, and as I heard from you, 10 years collecting the wood, 9 months making a single structure. And the moment you start to tell the story, all that pain and effort actually just goes into the background. And it doesn't come out. And which makes one think of the transient nature of material things, which come out so beautifully in the other two projects of things that are making and breaking, and you're looking at things which are there today and not there the next day. So I was just wondering if all this was a conscious effort to kind of link things together, or am I reading too much?
Yeah, I forgot to mention that, you know, like even when I saw this film, I mean this is an exception, I normally show it with those two structures out there. So you kind of go through that structure, you see that, you know, so much of work has gone into it, and but it's used as a set really, and that kind of, it's very evident that it's like eminently dismantleable because it's taken to another location, you know, two locations, and brought back into a certain gallery space or, you know, an exhibition space again. That, and also that you go through these structures, you see the structures first and then go probably see the film and come back and see it differently or become a part of it. It's also playing with this, what is real and what is image, what is representation and what is the source of that representation. So it's playing with all those like various opposite notions in a way that it all comes together in some way.
When I saw it at the NGMA, along with the structures, you know, then it made better sense. So then I requested Sudarshan that like we'll show the film. Shoonya Ghar, we promise we'll show you later some of these days. And he's promised us that we can show it. The reason was that's a 60 minute long film and the structures are not there. And I was a little afraid. Now looking at your response, now I'm far more encouraged to show it. But I thought maybe it doesn't kind of get a response, the kind of response the Manikal films used to get without the structures. And Sudarshan has been here seven years ago during our national, you know, Art Week of New Media, which we organized for the Chandigarh Lalit Kala Akademi, which had opened the eyes of many of those who had not been exposed to this kind of work earlier. So I thought now it is 7 years when a whole bunch of students from College of Art have passed out and there is a new, you know, set of students. They must also be exposed to his earlier work as well, which he very reluctantly showed us, although he would have been happier showing only that film. And now I think with that note, we should call it a day.